You see, the woe to them message comes from someone who may have their doctrines right, who may have their ethical values right, who may have a genuine concern for the state of the world, but they've stood outside of it and said, you are in trouble. And they've not come to the point of saying, it's actually woe to me.
Isaiah, calling people home, gives the good news that God restores us and gives us new life in Christ. Today's message is called, Experiencing the Holiness of God.
If you have your Bible this morning, I'm going to read from Isaiah chapter 6. Over a number of weeks, what we are really doing is spinning a stone across the book of Isaiah, the way you spin a stone across a lake or a river. Have you ever done that, where it bounces one place, then the next place, and runs three or four bounces, and we're not able to look into everything that is in this marvelous prophecy of Isaiah, but I do want to pick out some key themes and issues. And I want to look at a very important chapter this morning that may be one of the best known chapters in the book of Isaiah, when he has a personal vision of God, a vision which transforms his life and subsequently transforms his ministry. And I read from verse 1, Isaiah 6, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord seated on a throne, high and exalted, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him was seraphs, each with six wings. With two wings they covered their faces, with two they covered their feet, with two they were flying, and they were calling to one another, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty, and the whole earth is full of his glory. At the sound of their voices, the doorposts and thresholds shook, and the temple was filled with smoke. Woe to me, I cried, I am ruined, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips. And my eyes have seen the King, the Lord Almighty. Then one of the seraphs flew to me with a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with tongs from the altar. With it he touched my mouth and said, See, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away and your sin atoned for. Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, Whom shall I send? And who will go for us? And I said, Here am I. Send me. I have a book at home that is entitled, They Found the Secret. Some of you may have read it. It's been in circulation now for about 50 years. It is short biographies of 20 men and women whose lives were transformed. And the interesting thing is that it's the story of men and women who often, after being for years in Christian work, in Christian ministry, some of them missionaries, had an encounter with God that transformed their lives and changed their ministry. Some of them are well-known names like D.L. Moody and Hudson Taylor, founded the China Inner Mission, as it was then called. William Booth, who founded the Salvation Army. Amy Carmichael, a missionary to India for 54 years, and she never came home once because she couldn't leave the ministry, the girls, the young girls that she had rescued and was working with. A.B. Simpson, who founded the Christian and Missionary Alliance. And these were people who were already involved in ministry, and they had an encounter with God in some way that transformed their lives. I have another book here called Deeper Experiences of Famous Christians. And again, this looks at Christians through history. There's a section on Old Testament characters and New Testament characters. Then it looks at people like John Bunyan, John Wesley, George Whitefield, George Muller, Francis Ridley Havergal, and some I've already mentioned in the other book, Moody, General Booth, Charles Finney is mentioned. There are a whole string of people, and nearly all of them came into a fresh meeting with God, precipitated by some kind of personal crisis in their lives. Sometimes it was a sense of failure that they had been through. Sometimes it was despair over the fruitfulness of their lives. Sometimes it was some sin which caught up with them. But the result in all the cases was very similar. There was a deeper knowledge and experience of God. They discovered that Christian life and Christian ministry is not primarily about creeds and correct knowledge, but first and foremost about encountering the living God and letting him live that life in them by the Holy Spirit and their surrender of everything to him. And as a result, in all these cases, they became more fruitful and more effective. It's not just famous Christians, this title, Deeper Experience of Famous Christians. That is a pattern for many unknown Christians too. Some of you are recognized in your own life, and some of you may recognize the frustration and the failures that you've been through and the recurring sins that you seem to have no victory over, but you don't know what it is to have that fresh encounter with God. This chapter in Isaiah tells Isaiah's story of having been in ministry as a prophet for several years. We don't know how long. If Isaiah is chronologically arranged up until this point, as it may be, though the whole book is not chronological, then he has had five chapters of ministry, and you can read the kind of things he was preaching and saying prior to this event. But we know from chapter 1, verse 1, his ministry began in the reign of King Uzziah. And what happens here in chapter 6 is in the year that King Uzziah died. So we know this is not the beginning of his ministry. This is some while into it. And as he says in verse 1, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord seated on a throne, high and exalted, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Now, this reference to it being the year that King Uzziah died, I suggest to you, is not merely dating the event. We know the year that King Uzziah died, 740 BC. We have been able to work that out with reasonable accuracy. But it's more likely that the event of the death of King Uzziah was the means that brought Isaiah into this vision and encounter with God, which transformed his life. Because, as I'm going to suggest to you, King Uzziah had become a blockage to Isaiah directly meeting with God himself. Let me tell you a bit about King Uzziah. His story is both exciting and at the same time tragic. You read about him in 2 Chronicles 26, and you can read much of his story there. But I'm going to read you part of it. In 2 Chronicles 26 and verse 3, Uzziah was 16 years old when he became king, and he reigned in Jerusalem for 52 years. So that is a long innings for any king, 52 years on the throne. Verse 4 says, he did what was right in the eyes of the Lord, just as his father Amaziah had done. He sought God during the days of Zechariah, who instructed him in the fear of God. And as long as he sought the Lord, God gave him success. Now, this summary is a superb summary of a godly man on the throne of Judah. He did right in the eyes of the Lord. He sought after God. He was instructed in the fear of God. God gave him success, it says. And if you read in the following verses, you'll see some of the nature of that success. He was a great military leader that was necessary for the defense of Judah. He trained an army of 307,500 men. That was a big crowd for the size of the nation of Judah. And he provided them with shields, spears, helmets, coats of armor, bows and sling stones. They built machines to shoot large arrows, it tells us. And he probably invented, or his generals did, catapults for hurling large stones at the enemy. And they saw victory over the Philistines, over the Arabs, over the Ammonites. And verse 8 of 2 Chronicles 26 says, his fame spread as far as the border of Egypt because he had become very powerful. So as a military leader, God had given him victory and success. Domestically, he built new cities. He dug cisterns. It's a barren land there, but he just dug down and found cisterns and water. He bred livestock. He planted vineyards. And on every respect, Uzziah had an extremely successful reign. He was a hero to his people and a role model to the youth of Judah. Isaiah grew up in the midst of this. Isaiah grew up looking up to this great, good, effective, godly king. But then something went wrong. 2 Chronicles 26, verse 15 says, His fame spread far and wide, for he was greatly helped until he became powerful. And after Uzziah became powerful, his pride led to his downfall. He was unfaithful to the Lord his God and entered the temple of the Lord to burn incense on the altar of incense, which was something only a priest was permitted to do. But Uzziah had taken himself too seriously. He'd become proud. And when a man becomes proud, he assumes the normal rules don't apply to him. And he went into the temple, felt as the king he could offer incense, and he violated the instructions of God. And when he did that, there were 80 brave priests who confronted him and told him this was wrong, and he became angry and raged at them. And as he did so, leprosy broke out on his forehead. And verse 21 says, King Uzziah had leprosy until the day he died. He lived in a separate house, leprous and excluded from the temple of the Lord. And it tells us the Lord had inflicted him with leprosy. Now here's Uzziah, a great king, probably for 45 or more years of his 52 years of reign, when he had trusted God, sought God, feared God, God had empowered him, God had blessed him, but he became proud, was stricken with leprosy, and the last years of his life, he lived in a separate house, excluded. And somehow, he had become a blockage to Isaiah dealing directly with God. Now, I want to suggest two possible scenarios here. One scenario is because he doesn't explain why Uzziah had to die before he saw the Lord. But I suggest, firstly, that Isaiah was mesmerized by Uzziah. That is, King Uzziah was his hero. He'd grown up under Uzziah's success. He looked to him as a great spiritual leader, which he had been. Maybe he didn't know that his leprosy was a judgment of God. It may not have been widely known what he had done, that he'd become proud in that way. But being mesmerized by Uzziah, it is possible Isaiah's dealings with God were secondhand because he looked to Uzziah as a man of God, as a godly leader, but he was not dealing with God himself. And you know, that happens very easily. Sometimes we look at other people we respect and we look to, and we allow them to stand between us and God because we look to them to know what God is saying. We look to them to intercede for God on our behalf. Some wives look to their husband to be their spiritual leader, and he becomes a blockage to them. Some men look to their wives to be a spiritual leader. Women generally are more spiritual than men. And she becomes a blockage to his dealings with God. Some people look to their church or to their pastor or to a spiritual leader or some individual who they admire, and they admire their relationship with God. They admire their understanding of the scriptures. So what they're asking all the time is, what does he think or what does she think? What does he say? What does she say? What would they do? And they're not dealing with God himself. They're dealing with somebody who stands between them and God. We like to listen to people who spend time with God, but we don't talk to God ourselves. We don't listen to God ourselves because we fear, well, this person, this King Uzziah in my life, knows God better than I ever will. So maybe Isaiah was mesmerized by King Uzziah. Another scenario could be the exact opposite of that Isaiah was disillusioned by King Uzziah. Maybe he did know about Uzziah's sin and that his leprosy was a judgment of God on him. And he'd become disappointed at the behavior of this man of God. And as a result, his confidence has become shaken. And he's become disillusioned. This often happens too. There are people who stop going to church because of the behavior of some person or some leader. I met a lady in a supermarket. She came up and introduced herself to me. And she watches Living Truth, and she was evidently a Christian. And I said, which church are you a part of? She said, well, I'm not going to a church anymore. I said, why is that? She said, because the leaders made some decisions that I didn't agree with. So I'm not going anymore. So I thought a little bit and I said, well, is your relationship with the church or is it with God? Now her answer was, well, I can have a relationship with God without going to church. There's some debatable issues in that statement, by the way. Of course you can. You can be married and never do anything with your wife. When you become a Christian in a relationship with God, you become part of a community of believers. We're part of his body, baptized by the Spirit into his body. You can't live in isolation. But the point is this, she had become relating to the church and it had disappointed her and disillusioned her. So I was careful not to invite her to come here, because we would probably disappoint her in the course of time. In fact, you'll always be disappointed if you look to leaders and they are standing between you and God himself. You know, there's a word I thoroughly dislike and never use, but it's a word I hear quite often. It's the word unchurched. You know what people mean by that? People don't go to church. Well, I think the bigger problem is with people who've been churched. Churched. Not converted. I mean, church sounds like potty trained, doesn't it? You know, you've kind of been, you've been house trained to behave and be part of a church, but it's the church that you're relating to, not Christ, not God. And so when things don't work as we'd like them to, we get hurt. Don't put any human being on a pedestal. The value of any ministry is that we direct people to connect with God. And we do so by as quickly as possible getting out of the picture ourselves so you leave them connected. I think I talked a little bit about that last week, because Isaiah in the opening chapter of his prophecy talks about the fact that people have turned away from God. And so when you turn away from God, we often don't realize it, because what we've turned to are people who represent God. And we begin to relate to them. The interesting thing is that when King Uzziah died, Isaiah says, I saw the Lord, and where did he see him? Seated on a throne. Where had Uzziah been for 52 years? Seated on a throne. That when Uzziah, whether he was a blockage to Isaiah because he was disillusioned with him, or whether he was a blockage to Isaiah because he'd been mesmerized by him, is beside the point. When Uzziah died, Isaiah sees the Lord in the place where he's always been, but he wasn't in the mind of Isaiah, seated on the throne. This is a fresh vision for him. And I ask you this morning, What intercepts your vision of God? What intercepts your communion with God? Your relationship with God? What gets in the way of your doing business with God? Do you do business with God? Or do you run somewhere else? Is it in the Word of God that you spend time listening to His voice and speaking with Him? Or do you run after somebody else the moment you need some help? Some of us don't know the privilege and joy of God making Himself real because we never go to Him. There are two things that I'm talking to you about from this chapter. What Isaiah saw was the first thing. He saw the Lord seated on the throne. Second thing is what he experienced as a result of what he saw. And I want to suggest that two things he experienced. He experienced a new awareness of God, first of all, for I saw the Lord seated on the throne. Now, having said he had seen the Lord, he didn't see the Lord himself, as Scripture tells us, no man has ever seen God. But what he saw were symbols that surrounded his presence and symbols that portray a picture of what God is like. He was seated on a throne, that is, in a position of authority and power. He was high and exalted, a position of supremacy and sovereignty. There were seraphs around him who were serving him and calling out, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty, and the whole earth is full of his glory." Seraphs are a species of angels, they're different kinds of angels. This is the only time the seraphs, or seraphim, as they're called in the King James Version, occur in the Bible. And they have six wings. And in this instance, with two they covered their faces, with two they covered their feet, with two they flew. And we won't discuss the symbolism of those positions of their wings, though, because we haven't got time, that's the only reason. But what is important is that they were calling to one another, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty." They were proclaiming the holiness of God. But alongside this image of sovereignty and supremacy and authority and holiness, there is another atmosphere around the throne, which is an atmosphere of confusion and of fear and of uncertainty. Verse 4 says, "At the sound of their voices, the doorposts and threshold shook, and the temple was filled with smoke." That's enough to scare anybody. What in the world is happening? Well, you see, the holiness of God fits no earthly paradigm. There's nothing which you can say, this is what God is like, or this is a contrast of what God is. No, here is an atmosphere that is on the one hand an atmosphere of wonder and worship, on the other hand the atmosphere of confusion and uncertainty, with the threshold shaking, the temple filling with smoke. Is this an earthquake? What is it that's going on? Is probably how Isaiah was responding. Later in Isaiah 40, Isaiah said this, "To whom then will you compare God? What image will you compare him to?" Well, if he thought back to chapter 6 of his own book, he would have thought, well, I saw something and I felt something and I experienced something. It was both wonderful and fearful, but that doesn't compare what God is really like. These are just very inadequate images of him. God himself says in Isaiah 46, verse 5, "To whom will you compare me? Or count me equal? To whom will you liken me, that we may be compared?" You see, when you have a real meeting with God, we discover he is much, much bigger than we ever thought he was. The more you know God, the less you understand God. Because the more you know God, you realize he exceeds our understanding. When we don't know God well, we like to narrow him down to a very predictable pattern of action and behavior. But he's outside of all of that. And Isaiah's whole worldview is revolutionized by this encounter. He has a different view of God. He has a different view of himself, which I'll point out in just a moment. He has a different view of his work. He has a different view of the world. All of that comes in this chapter, which we won't have time to unpack this morning. But having met with God, he sees things differently, he thinks differently, he lives differently, he acts differently. But if what he experienced was first a new awareness of God, secondly, it was a new awareness of himself. Because in verse 5, "Woe to me," I cried, "I am ruined. For I'm a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips, and my eyes have seen the King, the Lord Almighty." To have seen the King is to see ourselves very differently. And you know something? What you see is not a pretty sight. When we see God in his holiness, we see ourselves in our unholiness. What is sin? I've defined this before, but it's important to keep reminding ourselves. The word sin comes originally from archery in its English usage. You take an arrow and you shoot it at a target, and you miss the target, and it's called sin. By how far you miss is irrelevant. You miss by half an inch, you've missed. Miss by half a foot, you've missed. Miss by half a yard, you've missed. Miss by half a mile, you've missed. Shoot in the opposite direction, you've missed. There is a sense in which God isn't interested in how bad we are. He's only interested in how good we're not. If you understand the difference, that we've missed the mark. Miss a bus by a minute, you've missed it. Miss it by 10 minutes, you've missed it. Miss it by 20 minutes, you've missed it. Miss it by an hour, you've missed it. You don't congratulate yourself when you miss a bus by a minute. Because that's fantastic. I only missed it. Wow, I'm getting really good. I missed it by only a minute today. God is not interested in how bad we are. He's interested in how good we're not. Have we missed the mark? Whether it's an inch or a mile. So what is the mark? Paul says in Romans 3 and verse 23, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." The glory of God is the moral character of God. It is actually the way he created human beings when he made us in his image, that we would be a visible, physical expression of God's moral character. God is love, we are to be loving. God is kind, we're to be kind. God is just, we're to be just. God is merciful, we're to be merciful. There's to be seen in human beings, in his image, a portrayal of God's moral character. But we have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And when God gave this revelation to Isaiah of himself, the seraphs were singing, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty, and the earth is full of his glory." What have we come short of? His glory. They put the target up, if you like. You see, you could be out in a field with a bow and an arrow, and you pull the arrow back in the bow, and you feel the tension on the string, and you feel the muscles standing up on your arm and rippling up your shoulder and across your chest as you pull it back with as much energy as you have, and you release the arrow and you shoot it, and you get great exhilaration out of the sense of power behind that arrow. But there's no target. You have no idea if you're a good shot or a bad shot. If somebody puts up a target and you pull back the same arrow and the same bow, and the muscles stand up across your arm and ripple across your chest, and you release it and it flies out and you miss the target, there's no debate as to whether you're a good shot or not. People can live their lives in the way they think best. They can commit any sin under the book with a totally clear conscience. I think it's okay. Who are you to tell me it isn't? When they see God, when they have a meeting with God, when they have a revelation of God, the target goes up and they realize, woe is me. It's like Peter on the day of Pentecost when he preached, told the people about Christ, went through his life, talked about his death, his burial, his resurrection from the dead, and he finished there in Acts 2 by saying, therefore let all Israel be assured of this, God has made this Jesus whom you crucified both Lord and Christ. Then the interesting thing is the next verse said, when the people heard this, they were cut to the heart and they said to Peter and the other apostles, brothers, what shall we do? Well, that's interesting. Peter hadn't told them they could do anything. What made them say, what shall we do? Because as Peter preached Christ and they saw Christ, they realized themselves. Because the moral character of God was seen supremely in Jesus Christ. The Word became flesh and lived for a while among us, and we have seen His glory. We have seen in Him what we have come short of. And when Peter preached Christ, the people said, what should we do? You see, people don't become aware of sin by us telling them that they're sinners. When I was a student in Glasgow, there was a fellow student who felt that if you're going to lead somebody to Christ, you have to make sure they understand they're a sinner. I mean, that's how he would begin talking to people, because he reasoned, if they don't know they're a sinner, they won't know they need saving. So basically, his approach to people was to say, excuse me, did you know you were a filthy, dirty, miserable, rotten, stinking sinner? And people didn't receive him warmly. And he used to tell us he'd been persecuted yet again for righteousness' sake. Well, it wasn't for righteousness' sake, it was for being foolish. What he should have done is told them about Jesus and his love and his character. And after a while, they'd say, do you know something? I'm a dirty, filthy, miserable, rotten, stinking sinner. That's what happened to Isaiah. Interestingly, Isaiah had been preaching prior to this. And if you go back into chapter 5, just for an example, in verse 8, he says, woe to you who add house to house and join field to field till no space is left and you live alone in the land. Woe to you, that is, who just build great cities and don't leave any greenery. He says in verse 11, woe to those who rise early in the morning to run after their drinks, who stay up late at night till they are inflamed with wine. Down in verse 18, woe to those who draw sin along with cords of deceit and wickedness as with cart ropes. Verse 20, woe to those who call evil good and good evil, who put darkness for light and light for darkness, who put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter. Verse 21, woe to those who are wise in their own eyes. Verse 22, woe to those who are heroes at drinking wine and champions at mixing drinks, who acquit the guilty for a bribe and deny justice to the innocent, and so on. The point is, in that chapter, he's saying this. He's saying, woe to you, woe to you, woe to those, woe to those, woe to you, woe to those. All the time in chapter 5, he's saying, woe to you and woe to those people who do such and such a thing. And then he has a meeting with God. And do you know what he says? Woe to me. You see, the woe to them message comes from someone who may have their doctrines right, who may have their ethical values right, who may have a genuine concern for the state of the world, but they've stood outside of it and said, you are in trouble. And they've not come to the point of saying, it's actually woe to me. Job had an encounter with God. It was a painful one. And Job, at the end of his book, says, my ears had heard of you. He's talking to God. My ears had heard of you, but now my eyes have seen you. Therefore, I despise myself and repent in dust and ashes. I'd heard about you. I knew everything about you before, but now I've seen you, and this is the result. I realize what a mess I am. I come to terms with myself. You know, personally, I get a bit tired of the woe to them message, which I hear often. And there is a place for speaking to the godlessness of our world and our society, but we don't have a right to preach the woe to them message unless we are living in the woe is me truth. Peter wrote 1 Peter 4:17, it is time for judgment to begin with the family of God. And if it begins with us, what will the outcome be for those who don't obey the gospel of God? In other words, if it begins with us, it will have its ripples that will go out into our world. But it doesn't begin with us. You can stand and shout at the world, you are wrong, you are wrong, you are wrong, you are wrong, and they won't take any notice at all. There's no reason to. You ask the average person on the street, what do you think of Christians? Often what they will tell you is not what we would like to hear. They know what we don't like, they know what we don't believe, they know what we think is wrong. But do they know that we love them? And do they know that we love them as we stand on a common ground as broken people with them? Woe is me. Later, Isaiah does say, woe to you and woe to them again. But now he's got the moral authority to do so because he's a man who knows his own sin and his own heart. And he is walking in honesty, walking in the light, as John puts it, of his own brokenness. That is what helps us to help other people. I'm going to show you that in just a moment as we finish. But why does God expose sin to us? Do you think in heaven, when a man says, woe to me, do you think God says, I'm glad, you know, stewing your own juice, man. I hope you really feel this badly. No, he does it, exposes our sin, never to humiliate us, never to condemn us, never to rub our nose in the dirt, but in order to liberate us and free us. And what happens to Isaiah is this in verse 6. Then one of the seraphs flew to me with a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with tongs from the altar. With it he touched my mouth and said, see, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away and your sin atoned for. Isaiah, yes, you are a sinner. You are guilty. Those words are used to him. But your sin has been atoned. Your guilt has been taken away. There's nothing so marvelous as knowing that you're clean, especially when you know you don't deserve it. We're clean, cleansed by the grace and kindness, love and mercy and justice of God on the grounds of the cross of Christ. It's interesting that Isaiah's sin seems to have had to do with his mouth. It says in verse 5, I'm a man of unclean lips. In a modern metaphor, he's saying, I've got a dirty mouth. Unclean lips. He touched my mouth and said, see, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away. Now, what was the problem with his lips, with his mouth? We can only speculate, but I suggest it may be that his very preaching, his woe to them, woe to them, woe to them, was his sin. Because he'd never yet faced the woe to me, or woe is me. You know, Jesus, who will one day be seen as the judge of the universe, who will occupy the judgment seat of Christ, said, I came not to judge the world, but but to save the world. It said in John 3:17, God did not send me into the world to condemn the world, but to save it. You don't save it by condemning it. You don't save it by judging it. There is going to be a judgment day, but that is not our business. That is going to come. The Lord Jesus was the friend of sinners. The common people heard him gladly. It was the tax collectors and the sinners. It talked about them as the ones who were his friends. When a woman washed his feet, the Pharisees in the home where he was having the meal, a man called Simon the Pharisee, the fellow Pharisees discussed this. This was embarrassing to them because this was a wicked woman, they said. They said, if he knew who she was, he would not let her do this to him. Exactly wrong. It's because he knew who she was. He let her come. Somebody told me one day about a neighbor they're having a difficulty with, and they said to me, well, at least they know what we stand for. I didn't have the courage to say this, but I wonder if they know that they love them, not just what they stand for. People knew Jesus loved them. It was, of course, the Pharisees, the religious people who had the biggest difficulty with Jesus. It's a wonderful thing to be clean. And I'll say what I've said here a number of times before. The only way sin leaves your body is through your mouth. You confess it. Woe is me. I am a man of unclean lips. 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And then I finish with this, and this is so important. If it was his lips that were unclean, if it was his mouth that needed to be cleansed, in verse 8, then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send and who will go for us? And I said, here am I, send me. And he said, go and tell this people. What does that mean? It means, Isaiah, engage your lips again. Open your mouth again. Go and tell. You know, very often, the area of our sin, when we've dealt with it with God, becomes the area of our ministry to other people. Because we understand this. And now, Isaiah's mouth is becoming a sanctified mouth. By that I mean, what had been unclean has become holy, and his cleansed mouth is going to be a means of his ministry. This is what redemption is about. It's not just, I forgive you, Isaiah. I forgive you for your unclean lips, and I forgive you for your dirty mouth. But now go and sit quietly in the corner and don't open your mouth anymore and just behave. No. Give me your mouth, Isaiah, the very thing that's been your problem, the very thing that's unclean, the very thing that's been exposed, give it to me. I'm going to take this and I'm going to use this as a means of bringing blessing to other people. You know, sometimes we fall into sin. Sometimes we find things overtake us and we get ourselves into a mess and we cry to God for mercy and we feel so acutely embarrassed about that area of sin. Have you ever thought that God might redeem that very sin and make it an equipping of you to bring blessing to other people? Because you understand people in a way you never did before in that area, the way somebody else doesn't understand them. You can come alongside. And you can become a vehicle for the grace of God. Let me ask you as I finish, are there things that are stopping you dealing with God personally, directly? The book I referred to, because it's about people in Christian leadership, for most of them, it was their ministry that had become their God. And God had to break it and meet him in a fresh way. Sometimes it's somebody else. That's my reference point. I go onto the internet to find out what so-and-so thinks about something. And I download their messages and I listen on my iPod and my brain is washed by what this one person thinks. Be careful. Be careful. Listen, by all means. Benefit from it. As long as it takes you back to God himself. That becomes a place of your dependence. Because then when the life of God is restored, as into Isaiah's experience now, the presence and life of God, the character of God, will begin to be expressed through us. And Isaiah preaches with a love and a compassion that he didn't know before. Even though he's being sent to some people who will hear but not understand, who will see but never perceive, who will listen but never hear, whose hearts will be calloused, he sends them off to a ministry of failure as far as human immediate response is concerned. And he tells them, you know, at the end of all your preaching, 80% of the people are going to be taken away. Only 20% will survive. Tells them that later in the chapter. So Isaiah, your ministry is going to be one of failure. It's going to be one of hardship. You need an endless capacity to be disappointed, Isaiah. But your identity, your value, your encouragement does not derive from your ministry. It'll be one of failure. It derives from God. And you'll find your strength in him, even though what you're doing now will seem to be so difficult. Of course, what he didn't know was that he was going to leave us one of the longest books in the Bible. We don't know what God is doing in our lives, but we know we have to meet with him in such a way that his beauty, his holiness is so real to us that our own unholiness is equally real, but we live humbly with the woe is me, but I'm clean, I'm forgiven, I'm cleansed, and the Spirit of God lives in me now to replace what I am with his character and his beauty, to work in love, to reaching our needy world.
Do you know someone who would benefit from this message? Share it through our website, livingtruth.ca. And while you're online, join the discussion about this week's message and follow the links to our Facebook page and YouTube channel. Tune in again next week when Charles Price continues his series on Isaiah with a message called Shoots from a Dead Stump. Christ in me.
Prophet Isaiah told the people of Israel things they needed to know but didn't want to hear. He told them there was a price to pay for disobedience, but he also told them how God offers comfort, hope, and salvation when people return to him. The 8-part series, Isaiah Calling People Home, gives the good news that God restores us and gives us new life in Christ. The Isaiah series is available on CD and DVD. Learn at home, give to a friend, or plan a group Bible study. Write to Living Truth to order by mail or call +1-416-222-3341 extension 113 or contact us through our website, livingtruth.ca. Isaiah Calling People Home shows how God gives us hope for the future.
What a friend we have in Jesus, all our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit, and all what needless pain we bear. because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. Have we trials and temptations? Is the trouble anywhere? We should never be discouraged. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Can we find a friend so faithful, who with all our sorrow share? Jesus knows our every weakness. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Are we weak and heavy laden, cumbered with a load of care? Precious Savior, still our refuge, take it to the Lord in prayer. Do thy friends despise, forsake thee, take it to the Lord in prayer. In his arms he'll take and shield thee, thou wilt find our soul is there. In his arms he'll take and shield thee, thou wilt find our soul is there.